For high-rise building, what we do is that we devise special type of structural system. We just do not go with this traditional beam column or beam column slab system. We employ additional type of or various type of structural system just to decrease the lateral deflection and just to stabilize the whole structure. So using an appropriate structural system is critical to good seismic performance of the building. So while moment frame is the most commonly used data loss resisting element, structural system data are also used as structural walls, frame wall system, braced frame systems. Sometimes even more redundant structural systems are necessary. That is, for example, in the case of 100 or 150 story building, tube in tube and bundle tube systems are required in many buildings to improve their earthquake behavior. Now we will, in the later lectures, we will study what are basically, you know, like how to stabilize the extreme high rise buildings. So initially, what, you know, like a basic term, what is the moment frame building system? So moment frame building system consists of these beams and columns. Columns are the vertical members, beams are the horizontal members. So they resist lateral loads through the axial forces, bending moments and shear force generated in both beams and columns. So beam and column sections should be designed as under reinforced sections, and they can be expected to undergo ductile behavior. Brittle shear behavior must be prevented through capacity design procedures. So while designing the structural configuration of the building, predominant flexural behavior in buildings and columns should be facilitated. And this can be achieved by using relatively long frame members. Short beams and column attract larger forces and are expected to fall in a brittle manner. So distance between beta and L by D ratio. The ratio beta is the ratio of pure flexural translational stiffness to pure shear translational stiffness. So what is basically this beta? So with increase in L by D ratio, flexural stiffness of member decreases and hence beta decreases. Thus a deformation is primarily dominated by flexural action members with large L by D ratios. On the contrary, flexural stiffness of member increases significantly and hence beta increases rapidly with decrease in L by D ratio below 1. So plane section remain plane but not normal to axis of member after shear deformation, and plane section remain plane and normal to elastic line after flexural deformation. This is the difference between shear deformation and flexural deformation. This is the arrangement where this is a 12 meter by 16 meter, distributed them evenly, and here you can see that the distribution of the columns is non-uniform. So in this case you can see here that the axial forces and the bending moments are much higher on these as compared to these, because the number of elements or, you know, like the number of members are larger as compared to this. Similarly for building A and building B, you can see here that there's larger shear force in the shorter beams as compared to this. And second, we will study about the structural wall frame system. So earthquake resistant buildings should possess at least a minimum lateral stiffness so that they do not swing too much during small levels of shaking. Moment frame building may not be able to offer this always. When lateral displacement is large in a building with moment frames only, structural walls are often called as shear walls so that it can reduce the displacement and can act like plate-like structural elements having large in-plane stiffness and strength. So the structural system of the building must consist of moment frame with specific braces having structural walls. So initially we had studied about the moment frame system. Now we are studying about the structural wall frame system. So they resist lateral forces through combined axial, flexural, shear action. In like introduction of shear walls, what basically happens is that we reduce the shear moment demands on beams and columns in the moment frame of the building. And structural wall should be provided throughout the height of the building for best earthquake performance. It should not be like we provide the structural walls for two story and the upper two stories, or we do not provide that. That is also very undesirable behavior. So it should be provided right from the foundation to the topmost level. And structural walls offer best performance when resting on the hard soil. For example, in this case, when we study what should be the ideal location of the structural walls, the number one option is that we can provide the structural walls at periphery. So this is in like small study where we have seen that what is the basically behavior after the providing structural walls. On the left you can see that the X translational time period was 0.72, but after providing structural walls it got reduced to 0.47. Along Y it reduces from 0.74 to 0.48, and for torsion also it reduces significantly from 0.65 to 0.33. Then the most important, you know, like the most significant difference is the roof displacement and extension got decreased from 21.6 to 11.9. and from along Y it got reduced from 23.4 to 12.4. Advantage of introduction of structural wall. This is without structural wall and this is with structural wall. We can see here that large amount of moments suddenly like got carried by this wall only, and for shear force also they also got reduced to a very large extent. The shear force was very high in this case, but all the shear force is now resisted by the structural wall. Number two option is structural walls in inner base. That is, we can provide the structural wall along this. I will personally, you know, like somewhat not recommend this. I will personally recommend you to add structural walls only on the periphery of the building, because by doing this we are increasing the stiffness along this area only and decreasing stiffness along this area. So here you can see that the displacement is also less and even like time period also got decreased. Third is this system, that is the innermost, either we provided in the form of lift well or even like provided in the form of structural walls. In this case also the displacement got very very reduced. That is, in the previous case it was approximately 10.9 mm, before that it was approximately 12.4 mm, and now it got reduced to 6 mm only. And option 4 is two separate structural walls. Here also you can see here that the roof displacement is also very less, that is 8.1 mm only. And option 5 is somewhat, you know, like eccentric, that is we brought structural from this point to this point and roof displacement is very very less, that is only 3.4 mm. So conclusion, that is long structural walls are more efficient than the number of short ones. How? We can see here that by providing two structural walls, the displacement got reduced to 8.1. By providing two continuous structural walls, the displacement got 3.4 mm. So the long structural walls are more efficient than the number of short ones. This is the difference between this, that is, it got reduced from 8.1 mm to 3.4 mm. Although you should notice that the base shear increases, because the stiffness increases. So this is the deformation profile. This is the bending and this is the shear force and this is the deformation profile of this. We should always avoid this type of thing, because we should always, you know, like design these beams for the actual high amount of axial forces that may come in the beam under the effect of earthquake forces. After that we will study about the brace frame systems. So structure, this type of system consists of moment frames with specific base provided with braces throughout the height of the building. So they are also provided in both plan directions so that no twisting or even like no localized twisting occurs in the structure. So they help in reducing the overall lateral displacement of the building and in reducing the bending moment and shear force demands and beaming along the building. So the earthquake force is transferred as axial, tensile and compressive force in the brace members. There are various types of bracing, that is X bracing, chevron bracing, K bracing. So they all reduce the bending moment, shear force and axial force demands in the beam and column of the original frames. These are the various type of bracing that are even like occur in the structure. Here you can see that it's a diagonal bracing, second is X bracing, third is V bracing, fourth is chevron bracing, fifth is K bracing and sixth is global bracing. This is also, you know, like used very widely in the high rise towers. So this is the ideal location of the bracing, that is along this and this. Here you can see that the difference between this RCC frame only, how bending moment diagram, you know, like you can see here, after providing global braces you can see that the bending moment significantly, you know, like become less, while in the case of structural wall it is between like in between this and this. There are forces but not high as high as this moment frame forces. After effect, then like the effect of shear force, you can see here that while in the case of this global bracing, the shear force even like decreases very well to very very less value. And here you can see that while in the case of structural wall, the shear force also got decreased from this to this, but not as much as this. Although axial forces, here you can see the difference. In this, you know, like all the axial forces are coming on this. While in the case of mount frame, the axial forces are behaving like this, and in the case of structural walls, there are some axial forces and then they are behaving like this. Displacement profile, you can also see here that this is not a desirable profile. This is also somewhat not desirable profile, and this is the most desirable profile because the displacement is also very, very less at the top. So that is why this type of behavior, this type of structure is always preferred. After that, we will study about the tube systems. So for tall buildings, use of brace frames and structural walls alone may be insufficient to control their overall lateral displacement as well as force demand on structural members. So in such cases, more rigid structural systems are required, like tube-in-tube and bundle-tube system, depending on the size and loading of the building as suggested. So in these type of cases, more rigid structural systems are required. That is, these, even like there are three basically tube systems. Number one is tube, second is tube-in-tube, and third is bundle-tube systems, which too depends on the size of and the loads on the buildings. Closely spaced heavy columns forming a closed loop interconnected with beams is called the tube, and it forms the first part of the lateral load resisting systems. Second, heavy reinforced concrete structural walls together, which is called as a core, form the other part. So tube system basically consists of one perimeter tube with a central core. Right now we're talking about a single tube system, so not tube and tube. So interconnection is important between the perimeter tube and central core. So a system of grid beam is used for this purpose, which consists of primary beams, secondary beams and tertiary beams. Here you can see that this is the inner RCC wall, structural wall system. Outer is the tube system. In between, these are the gravity columns that are not designed to resist any lateral forces. These are designed just to resist the gravity forces. And these are the closely spaced perimeter columns, which, you know, like stimulated tube system. And outer tube and inner structural wall is connected with the help of these beams. Here you can see that there are three basically systems that is possible. Number one is simple tube system with only main beams connected. Second, tube system with inner RC structural wall with primary as well as secondary beams. Here we are using tube system with primary, secondary and tertiary beams. So aspect of tube system is that perimeter draws most of the lateral force induced in the building during earthquake shaking. In the traditional frame building, what happens is that central core, most of the lateral forces are carried by the central reinforced concrete core. So the load transfer path carries the force to the concrete core. As the lateral force travels down towards the base of the building, the force flows towards the most different corners of the core in the form of axial tension and compression. So by introducing a perimeter tube consisting of a closely spaced columns interconnected with beams, the concentration of the force in the core is relieved, but the same behavior is shifted to the perimeter tube. So only, you know, like introducing this, forming a tube system and forming a structural wall system and connecting with beams, you know, like, do not complete the work of structural engineering. Structural engineering has to understand the complete behavior of the system. So by introducing a perimeter tube, this perimeter tube of closely spaced columns, the same behavior is shifted to the perimeter tube instead of this structural wall system. So all the forces here, which is being resisted by the structural wall, now after the introduction of these closely spaced columns, the whole behavior is shifted outside. So the axial stresses induced in the columns are smaller than those induced in the corner of a core of a traditional frame building. Second in leg effect that we should know in the high-rise buildings is the shear leg effect. What is basically a shear leg effect? So under the earthquake induced lateral forces, what basically happens is that there is a difference in axial forces amongst the columns on the leeward and on the windward forces. That is, the forces on the one side and forces on the other side, the forces are different. So in addition, the more the spacing the columns, larger is this difference in the column axial forces. So the buildings with traditional frame structural system have larger shear effect than building with tube structural system. This shear effect is not desirable. In traditional RCC frame system, this effect is somewhat predominant. But in tube system, this effect is somewhat controlled or minimized. So the earthquake induced lateral inertia forces is carried most by the stiffer frames. Hence, less stiff frames move more than these and thereby induce deformation in the beams. So here you can see that we are now considering two practical examples. Then on the left is a simple traditional RCC frame structural wall system, and on the right is a tube system. So we apply the same forces here. So here you can see that the difference is much larger. That is, this, you know, like you can see here that this slope is very high as compared to this area. Here the slope is very gradual. So the difference in column axial forces and compression and tension is less for the tube system as compared to the traditional RCC frame with structural wall system. Now we will study about the tube in tube system and bundle tube system. So this is best depicted by the example. This is a tube in tube system. That is, we made an outer tube and then we made an inner tube and then we made an RCC core. And bundle tube system is something like this. That is, we made tubes of, you know, like we made four type of outer tubes, then we made a tube of RC structural walls, then we made a tube of columns, and then we again tied. So this type of, you know, like structural arrangement is best suited for very high rise buildings. Now coming back to the definition of tube and tube system. So when the plan size of the building increases, additional columns may be required to support the gravity load between the outer tube and inner core. So thus the columns are not the part of the later load assisting system. That is, only the outer tube and the inner structural wall is a part of later load assisting system. So when the building plan is large, additional columns may be required to support the gravity loads. So it may be beneficial to create a bundle tube system, because in traditional system what we were doing is that we were providing this system and we were providing this system, but by doing this the span of the beam will be very large. So what we can do here is that we can also enhance the lateral capacity of this structural arrangement, and we can decrease the span of the beam, and we can decrease the deflection and or control all the earthquake forces by providing a bundle tube system. So how this system works? This system works by tying together and by increasing the stiffness. So basically what happens is that when we provide this arrangement, so the distribution of forces that was non-uniform in the traditional system, but it becomes uniform in this tube system, bundle tube system. So if the distance between the two tubes is large, intermediate secondary beams along with additional gravity column may become necessary. As you can see here that the distance between this structural wall and this outer tube was very large. So to reduce that, what we have done here is that we had brought in an additional tube here. So more uniform distribution of gravity forces is achieved with closely spaced beam grid between the tubes. So the RCC cores of the tubes are interconnected to each other. See here, these are the four RCC cores. These are also connected to each other with the help of these gravity column. Also helps us effectively to improve the distribution of gravity loads. This is the outrigger truss. Outrigger truss is the most widely used structural arrangement that is most often used to control the deflection in very large, very high rise buildings. So the role of the outrigger truss, this is an outrigger truss. From this point to this point, you can see here that these are the members, and here also you can see that these are the members. This is basically an outrigger truss. So it makes the column act together in assisting overturning moment acting on the building. It also helps us to greatly or significantly reduce the deflections in the buildings. So here you can see this is the traditional RCC frame building with the structural wall. See how much deflection it is occurring on this point. So if we here we have conducted a case study, this is a when we are considering a regular frame, this is the deformed shape. When we were considering a stiff core on the left side, perimeter tube on the right side, and outrigger truss on the top, the deflection reduces by only 1 mm. But the forces here, you can see here that the forces in the traditional system were very high here. But after providing outrigger trusses, the forces got uniform here. Here you can see that the outrigger trusses are provided in the four levels, and deflection got decreased by 36 mm. In addition to the already provided structural wall. And here you can see that at each and every junction of the outrigger truss and structural wall, the forces at the junction are very high. And after that, when we're considering this area, that is outrigger truss on the top only, the deflection is only 36 mm and the force uniform is very uniform. And after that, when we are providing this outrigger truss, extremely stiff outrigger truss connecting core and perimeter tube on the right side, what we can see here is that the deflection got decreased significantly. So the presence of stiff wall on one side alone does not help for very high rise building. So outrigger truss in tube and tube system is not beneficial. After that, we conduct another case study in which the structural walls are provided on the stiff cores are provided on the both sides. So this is a traditional system. After that, we provide a stiff core on the top, so outrigger truss on the top. So with this, you can see here that deflection almost got decreased by only 1 mm. After that, we provided two core structural walls and two outrigger trusses. Then we see here is that the deflection got significantly decreased to 24 mm. And after that, we provided stiff core on both sides and extremely stiff outrigger truss on the top. But that even does not help and deflection is quite high in this case. After that, the final solution. So the presence of stiff wall on both the sides and extremely stiff outrigger truss only decreases the deflection by 17 mm. So this is the suggested arrangement, that is, we should use outrigger truss in bundle tube system with high stiffness structural.